in the councils of government, we must guard against the acquisition of unwarranted influence, whether sought or unsought, by the military-industrial complex. The potential for the disastrous rise of misplaced power exists and will persist. We must never let the weight of this combination endanger our liberties or democratic processes.
The very word secrecy is repugnant in a free and open society. And we are, as a people, inherently and historically opposed to secret societies, to secret oaths, and to secret proceedings. We decided long ago that the dangers of excessive and unwarranted concealment of pertinent facts far outweighed the dangers which are cited to justify it.
On the outskirts of the national capital today, black limousines with darkened windows converged on a hotel where private security guards imposed ironclad control. The limos carried royalty, political power brokers, and industrial titans to a secret meeting that will last all weekend. It's known as the Bilderberg Group. Could their objective be world domination?
Council on Foreign Relations. Professor Carol Quigley is allowed to examine the confidential papers and secret records of this network. Quigley reveals that these men aimed to create a world system of financial control in private hands, able to dominate the political system of each country and the economy of the world as a whole. In short, they seek total and quiet control of the entire world. And the CFR is their most visible conduit for carrying out that agenda.
What I'm about to say is fact. The secret organizations of the world power elite are no longer secret. They have planned and are now leading us into a one-world communist government.
CNN has even reported that these individuals have put out the policy reports through the Council on Foreign Relations that writes their scholarly white papers to end the United States, to end Canada, and to end Mexico.
I hate to break it to you, but after 2 years of denying it and saying this can't be, it's the only reason that I have found that explains everything that's going on in our country with a border. Our country has been sold out in the name of global profits and votes at the ballot box. This is where the Security and Prosperity Partnership of North America, or SPP, comes in. This little agreement, international agreement, cooked up by President Bush, the former president of Mexico, and the Prime Minister of Canada. Their mission is to blur or completely erase the borders between Canada, U.S., and Mexico.
The Amero is the proposed new currency for the North American community, which is being developed right now between Canada, the U.S., and Mexico to make a borderless community much like the EU, and the dollar, Canadian dollar, U.S. dollar, and the Mexican peso replaced by the Amero.
Security and Prosperity Partnership, which critics call nothing more than a North American Union. It means open borders, commerce at all cost, and by the way, without the approval of either American voters or the U.S. Congress.
And very unfortunately, it's going to be like the euro dollar, you mean?
Well, that would be long, long term.
Now, even the economists supporting the so-called globalism, and it's not free trade.
Worse, critics say foreign policy elites are promoting a European-style union, erasing borders between the three countries, and eventually moving to a single North American currency called the Amero.
Be a 4,000-mile network of new toll roads with truck and car lanes, rail lines, pipeline, and utility zones. Its projected cost, $183 billion over 50 years.
By default of this agreement, the American Constitution will eventually be obsolete. You would think that a situation like this would be on the cover of every major newspaper. That is until you realize that the people who are behind this movement are the same people behind the mainstream media, and you are not told what you're not supposed to know. The North American Union is the same concept as the European Union, the African Union, and the soon-to-be Asian Union, and the same people are behind all of them. And, when the time is right, the North American Union, the European Union, the African Union, and the Asian Union will be merged together.
Vice President Dick Cheney takes a question from David Rockefeller.
Vice President, I just enjoyed so much your whole speech, but I was particularly pleased that you gave such a strong endorsement for the free trade agreement for all the Americans.
It's good to be back at the Council on Foreign Relations. As Pete mentioned, I've been a member for a long time and was actually a director for some period of time. I never mentioned that when I was campaigning for re-election back home in Wyoming.
I've never registered as a Republican, but generally speaking, but I think most Americans now say neither side, they're both selling us out.
I was one who supported giving President Bush the authority, if necessary, to use force against Saddam Hussein.
Well, I have a number of people from whom I get policy. I'm talking to Frank Gaffney. I talked to Richard Haass.
Richard Haass served under Colin Powell during this Bush administration over at the State Department. He's now the president of the Council on Foreign Relations.
The idea of a one world community, a new world order. You know, they see that as
they see themselves as a government as opposed to a group of world leaders or people with influence at a global level who are talking about global issues, do they?
They see themselves as headhunters. They'll get an up and coming politician who they think may be president or prime minister one day, and as globalist industrialist leaders who believe that politics shouldn't be in the hands of the politicians.
People talk to me about, you know, the issue of Republican versus Democrat as if they don't get it. And I say, look, here's the way you get it. It's organized crime. All you do is you call the Republicans the Genoveses and you call the Democrats the Gambinos. The people at the top, they treat it like a crap game, like it's their crap game, like they're making lots of money. Occasionally somebody at the table shoots each other, but the moment anything threatens their crap game, they all unite to protect it. They're both controlled by the same financial, economic, and corporate interests.
We have before us the opportunity to forge for ourselves and for future generations a new world order, a world where the rule of law, not the law of the jungle, governs the conduct of nations. When we are successful, and we will be, we have a real chance at this new world order.
It used to be more secretive. You know, the new world order was talked about 30 or 40 years ago, and nobody would say it out and open. Now they talk about the new world order, or they just think the world would be better off if we had one world government.
Right.
I don't. I mean, I don't even like the size of our federal government, let alone one world government.
There's a need for a new world order.
Within the next 4 years, we will see the emergence of a new international order.
The beginning of a new international order.
But there's a very, very clear-cut and easily identifiable system in place that puts all of these elements from media control to government control to energy control together into one apparatus working together effectively towards its final goal, which is, you know, global control.
A new world is emerging. It is a new world order.
It's a phrase that I often use myself, that we needed a new world order.
There is a chance for the President of the United States to use this disaster to carry out what his father, a phrase his father used, and that is a new world order.
There is a cabal, a conspiracy, if you will, to take control of the United States, lead us into a one world government run by them.
Americans have been taught to expect their salvation from government, instead of recognizing government as the most dangerous threat they'll face in their lives.